It's time to put our line panelists' chops to the test by putting them on the clock. They'll have just 1 minute as a group to tackle each of the following subjects. So we start with news that Albuquerque will be taking a step away from going green to save the city some green. The city fleet will no longer be running on alternative fuels like E85. Sophie, everybody gets where the administration's going on this, but this cost, and then there's cost.
Do you see my not thrilled face?
Right.
Yeah,
right.
My not thrilled face.
I mean, wasn't the point of this, if we pay a little bit more, we're saving a lot of things down the road?
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. And it seems to me, yes, everyone is trying to cut, everybody's looking for opportunities to save money, but this was a worthy program that I think should have been kept going. The one saving grace in my mind is that they're not, from what I understand, trashing the vehicles that use that technology, right. They'll still be available for us to pick up again when things get better.
What do you think?
Well, you know, I think that there's a relationship between when gas prices go up and the increased interest in, at the federal level and state and local level in using alternative fuels. Mm-hmm. And I think we've enjoyed up to now a fairly, you know, stable gas price. And I think as we head into the summer months, it's going to start to increase. And we're going to see nationally a lot more interest in trying to use alternative fuels. So
sure.
I don't know if it's wise.
Well, the problem was that the fuel was also corroding the engines and the fuel lines and costing the city an awful lot of money.
The maintenance was a big problem, yeah.
I'm just curious to know where the measure to cut travel time and use of those vehicles so that we're not having to use them. The greatest green impact we can make is not to drive them and to figure out a way to do the work another way. So
there you go. Well said. Now, early voting is on. It's underway in the June primaries. The reports show as many as half of all registered voters will have cast their ballots early this year. My girl wants to get in on this. How does that revelation change the strategy? Of the candidates out there.
There's, well, for one, I think a couple of interesting changes that, at least in Bernalillo County, will be happening. They're going to be printing ballot on demand in the early vote centers this time. Saves the county quite a bit of money, something like $300,000, I think, in this primary election. So there's an opportunity to push people to the polls and not have necessarily the paper shortage and cost-related issues. Mm-hmm. They're also hiring something like 3,000 poll workers who they still need to hire for that. So there's some, I think, a lot more interest in trying to make sure things run efficiently this time around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Martine, you're around this business of strategizing political campaigns. When you allot your money to spend your money, how does this change if half the votes are in already?
Well, obviously, our political strategy is to try and capture as many of those votes from the get-go. What alarms me, from a procedural perspective, is that what if there's a scandal or something is revealed 2 weeks before the primary where this person is completely incompetent and should not be in office and refuses to resign? Those votes have already been cast.
We're gonna have to let that be the last word on that one. That's dynamite. Now, this week, the president of the faculty senate at UNM announced his resignation, saying the administration has no interest in moving to a model of shared governance. Doug Field says his decision was based in part on the fact that the faculty and staff weren't included in recent budget talks. And Martine, you're at part of the graduate governance program there. What's your thought on this? Is there culpability on both sides? Is it clearly one side or the other?
I think the university overall in general has moved away from an integrative bargaining approach where everyone in the community owns the problem. And it's gone into a confrontational bargain where there's a winner and a loser. And I think that Dr. Fields or Professor Fields feels like he can't be effective, and it's sad. Mm-hmm. I wonder how this is going to affect the student organizations and if their voice is going to be muted. And I also wonder about the law school split from GPSA. Are we going to see the emergence of a competing student body for funds and for voice? The administration has a month to decide whether they're going to go ahead and accept the law school's charter. And all indications show that it is. Mm-hmm. So a lot of division at UNM right now.
Let me swing these guys in. Jim,
I'm sorry to see he resigned. He was really bird-dogging budgetary items.
Absolutely.
And I worked with him briefly on an ARCA where he discovered that money was being shifted from the academic budget to cover deficits in the athletic program. Mm-hmm. And that voice now is lost. I can understand him being completely frustrated, but I wish he'd stuck it out.
Sure. 10 seconds, Sophie. I
know and respect Jacqueline Hood, who was his predecessor in that position. And it's like a curse I wouldn't wish on anyone being in that role. And the hardball is played like you wouldn't believe environment.
Yeah. Absolutely. Now, a big victory this week for middle schoolers at Albuquerque Academy. You might have seen this on the front page of the journal. They won last weekend's Energy Department National Science Bowl. And Laura even got a pep talk from the First Lady. How exciting for these kids.
Very
that was
exciting.
A big deal. I love that.
A big deal, and I think it's great. I think it's amazing, given that we have talked so much about education, some of the education problems we have here. It's really nice to see a feel-good story like this.
Yeah, Jim?
Well, people don't realize one of the finest institutions of education in this state and in the West is it's national level. It's Albuquerque Academy. Mm-hmm. So congratulations to them. They earned it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, as an alum of 1995, graduate of Albuquerque Academy, I'd like to congratulate my fellow Academy community. The Academy's always had a dedication to science. We spoke offline earlier about how when you're told as a child that maybe you're not science material, the Academy always made sure I was science material, and I've continued that. So congratulations, AA.
Well done.
Yes. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it's a fantastic reminder of the importance of science education in our schools mm-hmm. at a time when it can be so discouraging seeing school districts pull away because of the debate over what is a theory and what is not.
Right, exactly
right.
Well done there.
Played out that way.
The headlines this week have been filled with the stories, you've seen them, of corruption and nepotism, this time surrounding the Bernalillo County Detox Center. Jamie Dantas, the son of the center's director, has been reassigned after allegations surfaced that he'd been coming to work impaired and was allegedly caught rifling through a client's personal items. Jim, by the way, why do these folks always get reassigned to Parks and Rec? Have you ever noticed that? It's always Parks and Rec.
It is.
But that's
where they go.
What's the deal here? I mean, this is a
Well, first of all, it's a sad story for this young man, if these stories are true. He definitely had a substance abuse problem that was destroying him. But more important, I mean, the city owes an obligation to the clients. Yeah. And I think the most poignant statement was from a fellow worker saying, what are we saying to this person coming in off the street when they're trying to fight these demons and the intake person is stoned
right.
and is nodding off because of drugs? This is not a good situation.
That was a tough quote right there, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's really sad to see. And it's interesting to me to see how many people, once it did hit the news and it was sort of public, were more than willing to share some of these stories and right. then criticize about how some of the logs weren't available, right. apparently, of the behavior that had been more problematic.
And that's the big one yet to be untold, is this missing information in the files. Yeah.
I completely agree with you. I mean, the only person who's really hurt here besides the citizenship and the faith in democracy is his son. Mm-hmm. And I hope that his father does the right thing and gets him the help that he needs. It just goes to show you that addiction and problems of that nature, no one is immune to it, whether you're politically connected, whether you work for the city. Tough times and just a tough life can lead to tough decisions.
Sure. And a tip of the hat to Jeff Proctor at the Journal. He's done fabulous reporting on this story. Now, we're always looking for topics to tackle at the Line Roundtable. Send us your ideas via email at infocus@kmu.org. Go hit us up on Facebook or Twitter.